something in the morning. That day is gonna come. That day is gonna come. That day is gonna come. You know I believe it. That day is gonna come. We're going to a place. We all belong. No more sadness. That day.
By your ability to do that.
That day is gonna come. That day is gonna come. That day is gonna come. You know I can feel it. That day is gonna come. I'll break through the ceiling.
A little bit of a build for the boys.
Don't spot leak, dude.
Bottom of.
You don't want to talk? Oh, look at this.
Better run, better run. Now I'm on my own. All the other kids with the pumped up kicks, she's better run, better run. Faster than my bullet. All the other kids with the pumped up kicks, she's better run, better run. Now I'm on my own. All the other kids with the pumped up kicks.
safe tonight. I feel the sun creeping up like tick-tock. I'm trying to keep you in my head, but if not, we'll just keep running from tomorrow with our lips locked. Yeah, you got me begging, begging, baby, please don't go. If I wake up tomorrow, will you still be here? I don't know. If you feel the way I do, if you leave, I'm gonna find you. Baby, please don't go, 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 go. Baby, please don't go, 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 go. Baby, please don't go, 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 go. Baby, please don't. Baby, please don't. Baby, please don't run away.
Wished for things that I don't need.
From my bed, start another day.
What I chase won't set me
stay
free.
Instead, I feel the sun creeping
up
like
scared,
tick-tock.
I'm
trying to keep you in my head, but if not, we'll just keep running from tomorrow.
Where the hell is
like
I was?
Yeah, you got me begging, begging, baby, please don't go.
Stranger than your sympathy.
If I wake up tomorrow,
take these things
so
I don't feel.
I don't
kill myself from the inside out.
If you feel the way I do,
my
if you leave, I'm gonna find you. Baby, please don't go, 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 go. Baby, please don't go.
De feu font la guerre à mon estomac et des amis. Je n'en ai pas, je me redresse tout plein de maladresse. Avec douance, je sombre en défaillance. Je vais seul, je ne m'en plains pas.
Hey, this is Nev Lapid from Snowboard Addiction. I'm here today with Tim, who is a brand new snowboarder. In fact, this is not set up. He's actually never snowboarded before in his life.
Never.
And what we're doing today is we're gonna be looking at different types of boards, how to buy a board, what to look for, different shapes. And Tim's gonna be asking me a bunch of questions about how to get set up with a snowboard.
Got a lot to ask. So.
We're right now in The Circle, which is a snowboard shop in Whistler, which is where we're based. It's one of the coolest shops in town. And I'm kind enough to let us film a little tutorial here.
Awesome.
So, sweet. So, there's lots of different types of snowboards, and there's no perfect board for everything, but I'm gonna give you as much knowledge as I can today on different shapes and stuff.
Cool.
First thing I wanna kinda ask is, do you know what kind of snowboarding you wanna get into? Is there something you've seen that you're like, I wanna do that?
Yeah, so a bit of a mixture, I guess, kind of being a skateboarder most of my life, you know, park appeals a little bit. Days of big stuff is done. I'm not gonna be throwing myself off massive, you know, I guess 20 foot. I don't know how big the jumps are, but you know, some.
Oh, you probably will be.
Yeah,
we'll be getting you going off 20 foot jumps after a while.
But yes, you know, it's like messing around, some little 360s, maybe some grinds and stuff. Yeah. But then also more on the surfing side of things, having done a bit of surfing myself and spending a lot of time in that industry, just some drawing nice lines on powder days and just doing some carves, getting some snow up, just cruisy down the mountain, nothing super fast and heavy power, but yeah, just a bit of kind of, I guess, all-rounder maybe, but yeah, that's where I'm at.
Cool. So with snowboarding, people who want to get into kind of freestyle, which it sounds like you do, it's nice to be able to get a board that you can both ride regular and switch. Do you know what stance you ride?
Yeah, I ride regular.
Regular,
so,
okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, because there's so many different tricks in snowboarding, like 180s and board slides and 540s, where you're switching your stance up all the time. It's really nice to be able to ride in both directions.
Cool.
Now, the other thing that you talked about is kind of like more like free riding, surfy feel, like slashes and stuff. That's also a sick area of snowboarding that everybody loves to do.
Yeah.
And the board types between these two are actually very different. So it's hard to get a board that does everything.
Mm.
But I'm going to give you the different kind of design concepts and show you what will work better for different lights.
Perfect.
Let's have a look at a couple of boards.
Cool.
So they have probably a couple hundred boards here. I just pulled a couple off the shelf here just to show you. I mean, you helped me pull them out. Tell me what you spot.
Well, there's a big variety of shapes, you know, different, like some are symmetrical, some aren't. Some have the where the bindings go further down. So I guess riding it in kind of one direction, like switch wouldn't work as good.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got ones like this one with a massive cut out kind of swallow fish tail, I guess. If that's what we'd call it in surfing.
Yep.
But yeah, there's the big variety between them.
So these first two boards are very powder focused boards. Those are, you're only going to ride them in one direction. Yep. You're not going to ride very well at all going switch. But in saying that, that'd be a hell of a lot of fun on a really deep power day.
Yeah.
But it's not the kind of board you want to get for all the mountain.
Yeah.
Okay. So this one here, huge swallowtail. It's a big nose, big wide board up here. It's going to be amazing in power. It's going to sink under the back foot. Same thing with this one. This is also a power board. You'll see the size of the nose is a lot bigger than the size of the tail, which means it's designed to float through the snow, float on kind of top of the snow.
Oh, yeah.
The stance is set back towards the back foot more, so you're always riding it in one direction.
Mm.
I mean, if you put it on the ground, you'll see that the back doesn't really raise up very much. So
it's pretty flat. Yeah. It's
not going to be a good one to ride switch on. Okay. Whereas some of these other boards that I pulled out here are just more kind of your all mountain freestyle type boards, which honestly is probably more like what you're actually going to go for.
Yeah.
So you'll see here, I mean, I'll pull this one out because this here is a very traditional shaped snowboard with a round nose and a round tail.
Yeah.
Now, sometimes you'll see other boards that have a little bit more kind of maybe squared off or shaped nose. Not a huge difference in that.
I was going to say, does it make much? Because you're not really riding on your nose or your tail unless you, I don't know what the term for it is, maybe like, is it buttering or something? I don't know.
Yeah, buttering, you're definitely riding up on the nose. But when you see these different shapes, most of it is marketing.
Okay.
You can, different things look cool or appeal to different people. So you'll see here, this one here, it has much more of an aggressive nose. Again, it's not going to make a huge difference to how it rides.
Got you.
But it's good. It's cool to have a board that you like the look of.
Yeah, I guess aesthetics wise.
Have you spotted the two differences between the mounting systems?
Yes, I noticed that this one, or most of them have this, classic bolt system.
Yep.
But this board has what looks like a groove or a track or something.
Yeah. So this type of, when you see these inserts, this is called a 4x4 or a 4-hole mounting system. Now that is the typical snowboard mounting system that's on almost every snowboard company's board. If you ever see this channel, this is called the EST channel, and it's a system designed by Burden, and you'll usually only find it on Burden boards.
Okay.
There's a couple of other companies that also have it too,
yeah,
but predominantly only on Burden boards.
Okay.
The thing you need to know about that is that if you buy a Burden channel board, you want to buy Burden channel bindings to go with that board.
Okay.
And if you buy a 4-hole mounting system board, you want to buy the normal 4-hole mounting system bindings to go with it.
Cool. And does it make much of a difference in terms of riding riding? Does it affect you? Is it?
So it doesn't make a huge difference to your riding. The main difference is that when a 4-hole mounting system, you've got 4 bolts per binding holding your foot on, and on a Burden channel system, you only have 2 bolts per binding holding the board to the binding. Now the difference, what happens with that, is that with the channel, because there's only 2 bolts, it's really easy to adjust. You can make a lot of different stance options and you can make it quite quickly.
Yeah.
Whereas here, you have to undo 4 screws. It's a little bit more work. It takes a little bit more time. But the advantage of that is a lot of people will argue that having 4 bolts per foot is much stronger of a mounting system.
Got you.
Holding your actual binding to the board or your boot to the board.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's your main differences.
Cool.
Functionality, ease of changing,
yeah,
and strength.
Cool. Yeah, perfect.
Awesome. So what we want to get into now is kind of, these 4 boards here are more of your typical all mountain riding boards. And like, we got a lot of different boards we can choose from. If you aim the camera down here, you can see John in the background.
Support Chris Rasmussen.
John, this guy, pull this in. This is a LibTech snowboard. Chris Rasmussen is a local pro from Whistler. Really cool dude, wicked rider, and he's got a pro model now with LibTech.
Well deserved.
One of my employees, shout out to Jesse, is actually riding that board. I think he bought it from here.
Did he?
Yeah, last year.
Oh, another guy bought one.
Yeah. Yeah, one of my employees got it. Anyway, so pull this over. This is another example of, you see how it's got a bit of a funky nose going on? Not going to make a huge difference to the riding. Mm. It's just kind of a different look.
Aesthetic, yeah.
But this is a cool board. So, what I want to show you is, of these boards, because you're new to snowboarding, you want to try out some freestyle, you probably want to go with something you can ride both regular and switch.
Yeah, okay? For sure.
So, one of the most important things with choosing a snowboard is coming down to what size board we should get. How much do you weigh?
Around the 82 kilos.
Okay, and how tall are you?
6 foot.
6 foot?
Yeah.
6 foot, 82 kilograms. Okay, to give you a bit of a reference, I'm 5'9", so 3 inches shorter than you, and 70 kilograms, so 10 to 12 kilograms lighter than you.
Yeah.
And what I generally ride, my all-mounted freestyle board, is usually a 154.
Cool.
153, 154, 155.
Yeah.
But 154 is what I'm riding.
Cool.
So, do you think you'd be on a bigger board or a smaller board than me?
I'm gonna guess bigger.
Yes, you're gonna be on a bigger board than me. So if I was to chuck out a ballpark number, I would say you're probably looking for somewhere around 158. 158, 159, 160 is what you're looking for.
Yeah.
Now, the shorter you go, the more playful a board's gonna be.
Okay.
The longer you go, the more, it's gonna usually have a little bit more stiff, a little bit more stability to it.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you were like charging, just wanted to ride fast, weren't too worried about freestyle, I would say go a little bit longer.
Yeah.
If you want to get more into freestyle, you want a little bit more playful, I would go that little bit shorter.
Yeah, I think the playful spectrum is more where I'm at than the go really fast and just straight down kind of thing. So.
Yeah, so total ballpark, I would say something around a 157, 158 is going to be good. 158, 159. So let's pick a board like that. I think this one was a 159. Okay, this is a 159.
Cool.
So if we put this up against you just for a reference, you'll see that the 159 is coming up to just about your chin here, just under your chin, a couple centimeters. And if we grab a 155, 155 is at about my chin, and I'm usually riding about a 154.
Cool.
So you probably don't want to get anything up above your chin.
Yeah.
Because it's just going to get a little bit long unless you are riding deep powder.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Definitely.
Sometimes on the back of boards, it will give you a weight and height recommendation. So check out the back of the new boards and see what it says. Does that one have a weight and height recommendation?
Doesn't look like it. It's just more about the board itself and its specs.
So I know that this Capital one does have a weight recommendation because I spotted it just before. So this is a 152. So it's a board that's too short for you.
Yeah.
And if you see the 152 here, it gives a weight recommendation of 50 to 68 kilograms.
Okay.
So you're
80 to 82-ish.
Yep. So have a check out the back of the boards and see if you can do that. But if you can't find that, think about this. Somewhere around your chin or a couple of neck to chin is gonna be a right height.
Yeah.
And if you go shorter, it's gonna be more playful. If you're gonna go long, it's gonna be a bit more aggressive, a bit more stiff.
Cool.
Make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Cool. What size are your feet?
Feet, UK, well, 8.5 UK, so, but I buy size UK 9 shoes. So that's like in, it's European, it's 43.
That's about, I think that's 10
US. I think it's 10 US, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool. So size 10 US is right on that borderline where if you had a size 11 or 12 US foot, you'd want to get a wide board.
Yeah.
Now, when I say a wide board, that means that the board is actually made wider on purpose for people with big feet.
Got you.
With your size feet, you're gonna be in the perfect size to not need a wide.
Cool.
Okay?
Yeah.
That's important to look for because sometimes boards will be wide and if you get a wide board and you don't need it, it's gonna take more effort to ride.
Yeah, I've noticed that the difference in widths and stuff, and I did wonder how that would affect riding and performance and stuff, so.
Now, to give you sizing on snowboards, you can hold that, is that the vast majority of adult male snowboards are gonna be somewhere from 150 up to 160. The vast majority are gonna fall in that range, okay? Now, the smaller boards are a little bit lighter, a bit softer, they are a little bit thinner, and as you get bigger, they get that little bit wider, that little bit stiffer to hold the bigger weight and bigger height and bigger mass of people.
Got you.
Okay? So, because you're 6 foot, 80 kilograms, you're gonna be at that slightly bigger range riding something like a 150, 157, 158.
Cool.
Cool?
Yeah, sounds good.
Awesome, okay. Now we're going to get into some different types of shapes. Okay?
Yeah.
Because there's lots of shapes to snowboards.
You say this one's already got some kind of weird...
Oh, see, when I say shape, you're talking about this. I'm talking about a different type of shape.
All right, there we go.
But just to work on that, the shapes of the nose and tails don't matter too much.
Okay.
It's more of a marketing play.
Yeah.
But what does matter is what's called the bend of the board.
Okay, so like a rocker on a surfboard and stuff like this.
Correct. Cool. It's the same kind of name, actually.
Yeah.
So in snowboarding, it's called rocker, camber,
yeah,
or a combination.
Okay.
It's basically what it comes down to.
Cool.
So, do you know what camber means?
No. Is it like concave on a skateboard? Because on a skateboard, obviously, you have the concave is how deep the bend in the board is. Is it similar to that? Or
I'll show you what it is. So, this board here is a camber board. Now, a camber board, basically, this is what camber is. It's like, it's the shape like that.
Okay.
So, if you push this, see how it's got, I mean, it'll even look better if I put it on the concrete, because the concrete's flatter. But can you see that?
Yeah, it's got some give underneath it.
Yeah. So this board is shaped like that.
Okay.
That's the camber of the board. Okay. That's why it springs back. Now, if it was a reverse camber, this would be flat and it would kind of almost shape like a banana. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
There's not too many boards these days that are actually full reverse camber boards anymore.
Yeah.
Let me give you kind of the quick difference between rocker, camber, and combination. Rocker, which is like a banana,
mm-hmm,
is generally best for beginners,
yeah,
or people who aren't, or like brand new to snowboarding. But in saying that, I know you've done surfing and skateboarding and stuff, so I don't want you to go out and buy a rocker board.
Okay.
That's for people who are going to be like on the bunny slope.
Yeah.
Right? Camber is generally more aggressive, gives you better pop, gives you better response, but you have to put a little bit more work in to ride a camber board.
Okay.
And a combination camber, which is basically a combination of regular camber and reverse camber,
yeah,
is kind of the middle ground.
Interesting.
Okay. So a lot of intermediate riders out there these days are riding combination camber boards.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of like the high-end riders, like the people in the X Games and the Olympics, are riding camber boards.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Most of your boards you're going to find are either going to be camber or combination camber.
Yeah. What would a combination camber look like? Does it kind of go from one to the other?
I'm going to show you right now.
Cool.
So this is what you want to look at. So if I take this board right now and I look down the edge of the board, I want you to put your eye down here and I want you to see if you can see the shape of the board.
Yeah, it can. Yeah.
Can you see it?
Yeah, it kind of bows out this way, then drops down, then bows out again.
Yep.
Yeah.
So what I'm looking at is, yeah, that bow out of the board. I'm gonna get another one that even shows it better and then I'll show it to the camera. Okay, so camber versus combination camber. This board's the Capita DOA. And on the back of the sticker, it quite often tells you what the camber of the board is.
Yeah.
So you'll see on this one here, the vast majority of this board is a positive camber, which is regular camber.
Mm-hmm.
But it also is saying it has a zero camber here and a zero camber here.
So it's just flat.
Yeah, a little bit of flat on the nose and the tail, and then a positive camber. So if I put this on the ground, you see that? The vast majority of this board is a regular camber board.
Yeah.
Okay? So there's lots of different combinations. It has a little combination. This one here, this is the Libtech T-Raz, and it has kind of a combination of different cambers to it. So if we find the sticker, so on the sticker here, you'll see here how it's got rocker in the middle, camber over each foot. And then if you have a look down the edge, actually it's going to be easier if I put it on the ground. Okay. See how it's different than this one?
Yeah.
This one springs back. This one doesn't. It actually has a little bit of camber on each foot with a rocker in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
So that's a very typical example of a board that is a combination of the two cambers.
Got you.
Right? Now, a lot of intermediate riders are riding these boards that have combination cambers. In fact, that's probably going to be something that's going to be good for you.
Yeah.
Because you've done surfing and skateboarding, you're going to pick up snowboarding pretty quick.
I hope so.
So I would say something like this is going to be really good.
Yeah.
And then a couple years down the road, as you become a really good snowboarder, you may want to try out some regular camber boards.
Yeah.
To see how that feels.
Cool.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Because the main difference is, this is going to be a little bit more forgiving. That's going to be more aggressive. It's going to be, come on.
Can I interrupt? We we need to get into this case.
Yeah, come on through,
absolutely. Yeah.
So, the main difference is going to be that a regular camber board is usually stiffer, gives a little bit more grip, a little bit more pop, have to ride it a little bit more aggressive, whereas these combination boards, a bit more forgiving.
Cool.
Make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
So for most intermediate riders, the combination camber is actually pretty good. Whereas myself, I actually ride regular camber.
Yeah.
Because I want that extra aggressiveness, I want that stiffness, I want that pop.
Yeah.
Make sense? Sweet. 100%.
So,
we're starting to get a bit of an idea now on a board. We know the rough size range you're looking for. We know the rough board shape, something that's going to be both, you can ride it both regular and switch.
Yeah.
And we know kind of a bend, which is one of these combination camber boards going to be good.
Yeah.
So now we can start looking for real boards.
Let's get into it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right. So what we're doing now is we're sifting through some boards, looking for stuff 58, 59 kind of range, and then we're going to talk about them. So,
got a 158 here.
Yeah, grab that out. This one's a 159. So we went through and just picked out a bunch of boards here that kind of like in your size range.
Yep.
And let's talk about them. So this is a Nitro, Brian Austin. What do you recognize about this board?
It looks like a powder board.
It is a powder board.
The bindings are slightly further back. You're going to be on the tail more. The nose is longer or bigger than the tail.
What size is that one?
I think it's 159 when I pulled, I think, this one.
Yeah. So to find the size of the boards, you're either going to look, you're going to look like on the board, sometimes on the edge. So this one here is on the edge, 159. So that's about the right size for you, except this is a power board and we want to get more of a...
We don't want that.
Yeah. So put that one to the side. This one here, what size is that one?
I think this was a 158. Or 57.
157. Yep. So that's 1 meter, 57 centimeters.
Yeah.
And that one there is on the small side of what we're looking for you.
Okay.
But this could be something that you could ride. What's the bend on that one?
Looks like it's on the back. It's positive camber.
Yep.
With
so this
a bit
one's
of
a
reverse
positive camber.
So it's a combination.
Yep. A but it's
bit.
More. This one's more of a. It's got a full positive camber through there.
Got you.
So. Possible.
A maybe.
Possible.
We'll put that in the maybe part.
Yep, put that one in the maybe part. Okay, this one we looked at before.
Yeah.
It was the LibTech T-Raz. And was it 159? Combination camber.
Yeah, one other thing I noticed when I was picking out some boards and looking, that the edges can vary in like thickness and also the profile. Like this one, for example, I see it has kind of like a wave
correct
to it. Does that make much of a difference, or is it again just an aesthetic thing? Or
so if you look here with the camera, you can kind of see that the edge of the LibTech boards waves on the way down, and what's that? That's called magnet traction. So that's a technology that LibTech uses on their boards, and it's designed to be able to give you better grip and ice.
Got you.
Okay, so some LibTechs have it and GNU boards have it, but other boards don't have that technology. Some other companies have their variation of it, called frostbite edges. Not essential.
Got you.
It's just something that's unique to these boards.
Yeah, cool.
Okay? Whereas if you look at most traditional boards, like, let's just have a look at that. This is a Burden, it's called a one-hitter, and it's basically just got a consistent edge the whole way down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
So not a crazy, you don't need to worry about it too much.
Grab that.
Okay. So that LibTech board is something that we could definitely consider for you. So put that on the consider pile.
Make this new pile.
This one here is a Burden one hitter, and that's a 60, a 160.
Yeah.
So just putting that up against you there. Kind of the 160 almost comes up to your chin. Slight more of a powder focus.
Yeah.
So I would say maybe not.
Right maybe now. Not. Cool.
If you just want to ride power more, get something like that.
Yeah.
Because you could still ride that over the whole mountain. This one here is the Capita Kazoo Pro. I want you to feel how stiff this one is. So when I say feel it, hold the top and then try to bend the bottom.
Yeah, it's pretty, feels pretty rigid, but I don't really know what to go by in terms of
so
how.
Do this. I want you to feel that stiffness. Okay, and then I want you to grab this LibTech and do the exact same. Do the same thing. Feel the difference?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so softer, stiffer. Now, what you're gonna find is a stiffer is gonna take more energy to ride. It's gonna give you good stability at super high speeds and gonna be a good off big jumps and stuff like that. But this is going to be more forgiving, more playful.
Cool.
Makes sense?
Yeah.
So because you're learning, better to go for something more playful, playful and softer.
Yeah.
Now, the reason this is so stiff is it's a regular camber board, and Kazu is a pro rider. This is his pro board.
Got you.
And he's a very aggressive rider.
Yeah.
So I'd say that was too aggressive for you.
Cool.
This one here is a Yes board, which is a local company up here. And when you get into the back of the boards, you can kind of read about what the board is.
Mm-hmm.
And again, this one is called Pick Your Line. So it's, if you read about it, it's again more of a bit more of a powder focus board.
Yeah, I can see kind of the shape. It looks like it's slightly wider on the nose, definitely. And
correct. A bit wider on the nose, a little bit bigger nose than tail.
Yeah.
So we'll put that on the nose bar for now. These are sick boards, but
not what I'm after.
Yeah. What do we got here? Quan. This is a Dinosaurs Will Die 158, right in the right size range. Very traditional board, very traditional freestyle board. It's a regular camber. It's called Action Cam. Feel the stiffness of it?
Pretty forgiving.
Yeah, it's kind of in between those other two, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is maybe, but the combination camber might suit your riding style better.
Cool.
This one here is another Dinosaurs Will Die, Mate. I'm looking on the back of this of the boards because I'm kind of reading about what it is. So this has a low rider camber, which looks to me like it's almost like a reverse camber, according to this. What's the low rider camber, John?
They call it like micro camber, so it's just less camber. So yeah. It's like, I don't know the exact dimensions on it, but it's like maybe 2.5 millimeters camber, I think.
Yeah.
So the idea is that it's going to ride like a well broken in camber board. So it's still going to be poppy and carb really nice.
Yeah.
But you're not having to fight it as much.
Okay. So some of these boards here are going to be some of the better ones for you to choose from. Dinosaurs Will Die, Libtech, T-Raz, this Capita one, and then this Yes Unink. And these are like four kind of boards that would be the right kind of range for your size and the right kind of board for your ability level. And then you got to choose what graphic you like. Because graphics are always important too. You know, you might as well like what you're looking
for. Yeah, for sure.
Like what you're riding. So is there something you kind of like are leaning to?
Quite like the Capita.
Yeah?
Quite like monochrome or neutral tones, nothing too big graphics. Like this is a bit,
yeah,
bit crazy.
Yeah, you're more into that kind of style?
Yeah, more of a like minimalist, I guess.
Yep. All right. So, what other questions you have regarding boards?
I mean, does it make, obviously you're going to have to pick bindings to go with the board.
Yep.
And does that, I guess that's a whole nother ball game, is what bindings to get to go with the board. Does it make a difference? Certain bindings will be better with certain types of board and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But as a whole, in terms of the board, I think my only other question, what are snowboards made of?
Wood.
Wood.
Wood and fiberglass.
Okay. Because yeah, I see like metal edges and I was like, oh, I wonder what's actually inside this thing. I haven't, you know, didn't really know.
Let's talk about that. As Tim's asking about what is an actual snowboard made of. It's basically wood, fiberglass, and metal. So the inside of the board is a wood core.
Yeah.
And that's what gives it its bend and kind of bend and pop back.
Yeah.
Because wood bends and wants to pop back to its normal shape. And then you've got layers of, on the bottom here, you have a base material called P-Tex.
Mm-hmm.
And then in between the wood and the P-Tex, you have fiberglass. And then on the top sheet, you have fiberglass underneath the top sheet's basically just got the graphic on it.
Yeah.
You've got fiberglass in between the top sheet and the wood.
Yeah.
And then you've got metal edges to help grip in the snow and metal inserts to attach to the bindings.
Cool. Yeah. Did not know that.
Okay, so we're here with Tim and we've been looking at different board shapes, board designs, that kind of stuff. And we've come up with a few conclusions.
Yeah.
One, we know Tim's size, 82 kilograms, 6 foot tall. So we've come up with a rough size. Somewhere around 58, 59, okay? We've talked about the kind of riding you want to do. You want to get into some freestyle, learn some park stuff, and also have a good time riding the mountain. So you want to get a board where you can ride both regular and switch an all-mountain freestyle board. And third, we talked about the shapes like camber, reverse camber. And because you're a beginner and learning to snowboard, you want to go with something a little bit softer.
A bit more forgiving. Help me out a little bit. Yeah.
And that generally means if you pick up a board and you flex it and it feels real stiff, don't go with that. Go with something softer. Generally, a combination of camber and reverse camber combined together is going to work well for you.
Perfect.
Make sense?
Yeah, definitely.
Then you got to go and look at all different kind of graphics, pick something you like, pick a brand you like.
Kid in a candy shop in all these stores.
There's lots of boards to look through, but you're probably going to be riding this board for a couple of years. So
yeah, definitely investment. Like. So I guess next steps, boots and bindings.
Correct.
I have no idea what I need. So. All right.
Okay, so have you ever put a pair of snowboard boots on before?
Never.
Okay.
No.
So the most important thing with boots is to find something that's comfortable.
Okay.
Comfortable, supportive.
Yeah.
So my highest recommendation if you're going to looking for a pair of snowboard boots on, is go to the shop and try on every single pair. Okay? What size is your foot?
I guess US 10. I'm a UK 9.
US 10.
Yeah.
Okay. So go in and try out the US 10, but then also try out the 9.5 and try out the 10.5 and see what feels better for you.
Yeah.
You want a really snug fit, but you want it to be comfortable.
Yeah.
Shouldn't be any weird pressure points or anything.
Got you.
Okay. Now, as you get really good at snowboarding, most high-level snowboarders want a very kind of supportive boot. And when I say supportive, it generally slightly more on the stiff side. Because you're learning, it's not so important.
Cool.
You're going to be in these boots for sometimes 6-7 hours if you're doing a full day.
Yeah.
You want to be as comfortable as possible.
For sure.
Got it?
Yeah.
So trying on lots of boots. Different lacing systems. This is a very traditional lacing system here. Whereas this one here is called the boa. Okay, now the boa, it's basically just a flash lacing system where you push it on and twist it, and it tightens up for you. I ride boas, it doesn't matter, you don't need to ride boas.
Is it personal preference or is it
personal
speed?
Preference.
Yeah.
Speed, personal preference.
Got you.
Yeah. Some people still like traditional laces. I guess I'm kind of lazy, so I like the boa laces.
Yeah, perfect. Right?
So comfort. Got you. Support.
And what would you, when you're wearing a snowboard boot,
yep.
do you just wear normal thick, like walking boot socks, kind of anything like that, or?
Snowboard socks.
Snowboard socks.
You know, any socks are going to be fine.
Yeah.
But if you want to buy nice snowboard socks, they provide a little bit more support, good warmth. They're normally made of like good materials like wool, help you keep your feet warmer.
Perfect.
And then when you do your foot up in the boot, you shouldn't be able to lift any part of it. Like you shouldn't be able to lift your heel.
Should be fully wedged in.
Correct.
Got you.
If you can lift your heel, that's not a good fitting boot.
Got you.
Make sense?
Yeah, 100%.
Your toes shouldn't be scrunched up on the end. It should be nice and supportive and like feel like that when you make a movement with your foot, that's going to transition.
The whole boots get moving as well.
Does that make sense? Okay. It's all about trying on a bunch of pairs, walking around in the shop. Don't worry about putting both pairs on and walking around and feel it out.
Got you.
Cool?
Yeah.
Okay, bindings. So, boots are more important.
Mm-hmm.
Get the comfiest boot that you can find because you're learning, you're going to be spending a lot of time in it.
Yeah.
When it comes to bindings, you just have to make sure that the binding fits the boot you have.
Got you.
So most bindings come in three sizes, small, medium, large. Some companies might do like a small, medium and a medium, large, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want to, ideally, if you've already picked your board and you've already got your boots, try bindings out on the board. You know, you can even screw them on and see how your boots fit into those bindings, okay?
Yep.
Because this is your connector between yourself and the board. And so the more optimal the fit, the better you're gonna be able to transfer that into your snowboarding.
Got you.
Make sense?
Yep.
So, if you're with your size foot, which is like a 10 US, you're most likely gonna ride a medium binding.
Cool.
So if I was to grab, this here is just a pair of union bindings. And see on the bottom here, it's a contact pro binding black M. So that's a medium binding.
Mm-hmm.
So once you've picked your boots, you can fit that into your boot and see how it feels. Now, bindings are very adjustable. So you'll see here how it's got holes and screws.
Mm-hmm.
So you can adjust the toe strap and the heel strap so that, like if I was to put my foot into this right now, now, a snowboard boot's much bigger than a shoe, but basically, once you've got it on, you almost want it to be pulling directly down on the boot in a very central way. So it shouldn't be pulling like from one side or the other.
Yeah.
Or sometimes if the binding's too big, you like get to the bottom and you can't tighten it anymore, but it's not tight.
Mm.
That would mean the binding's too big for you.
Cool.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's all about fit. Does it fit the boots well? And most of the bindings are very adjustable. So you're probably gonna be on a medium.
Cool.
Make sense?
Definitely.
Medium, okay. If you have a very large foot, you're going to large binding. If you have a very small foot, small binding.
Yeah.
If you have a kid's foot, kid's bindings. Okay. The only other thing to watch out for bindings is there's two main mounting systems. We talked about it when we did boards.
Yeah, the Burton mounting system versus the regular four pin, is it, or four hole?
Correct. So this is the 4x4 mounting system.
Yeah.
And most binding companies have that 4x4 mounting system where it comes with a disc and you have four screws. And then the other one, obviously, is the Burton channel system. If you flick behind you there, you'll see that, the Burton channel. If you're going to buy a Burton channel board, get the Burton channel EST bindings.
Cool.
And what that'll look like is that it'll have two screws, which will be on the outside of the bindings. So it won't have that disc.
Mm.
Make sense?
Yep.
Cool. Yeah. So that's bindings. Pretty simple. The more you pay, the better binding you're going to get.
Yeah.
The cheaper bindings, there's nothing wrong with the cheap bindings. It's just better materials and better technology.
Last longer, durability.
Yeah.
Does a binding affect riding style and performance much, or is it just literally to lock your foot into a board?
Lock your foot into your board, but there's different bindings for different things. Now the good thing is that most of snowboarding's pretty standard these days.
Yeah.
So freestyle, like you'll see most of these bindings here are like an all mountain freestyle binding between these different companies. So it really comes down to how much you want to pay, what you like the look of.
Cool.
So I'd say this one here is $289 Canadian. That's probably a good mid-range freestyle binding. It's not like the super expensive stuff, but it's not the super cheap stuff.
Yeah.
Makes sense? Any questions on bindings?
No, I think are they all universal in terms of how you enter the binding? So you just strap off, put your foot in, strap on.
Yep.
Cool.
Mostly. There's a couple of other companies that do some different things.
Okay.
There's one company called Flow where you have like a rear entry. It's not very common anymore.
Mm.
Vast majority are like this. You have the toe strap and the ankle strap.
Cool.
Vast majority.
Yeah.
Burton has a new one called Step On, where it's like a step-in binding system. I don't know if you've seen that.
No, I haven't.
It's
not
super common yet. This is what almost 90%+ of snowboarders are going with.
Yeah, cool.
Standard two strap.
Sounds good.
Cool. I mean, let's have a look at a couple. So, like, this is the same company, obviously a much funkier color scheme.
Yeah, quite bold.
Feel the difference between the straps there, like the ankle strap.
Yeah, that one's pretty thin. That one's super padded, feels a bit more rigid as well.
Yeah, so it's more of a supportive ankle strap. And so that binding there is a more expensive binding.
Mm.
It's not that, it's only $40 more, $329.
Cool.
So let's have a look at a couple other ones while we're here. This here is called Now, which is a local company.
Cool.
Made by an ex-pro snowboarder who lives in the Whistler area.
Nice.
This has a different technology. It's got a pivot point in the middle of the binding, and it's almost like, you know how skateboarding trucks?
Yeah,
how you can kind of lean towards your heel edge or your toe edge? This has a slight bit of pivot in the binding.
Okay.
That gives you more of that surfy, skatey feel.
Nice.
Now, this again, the entry is the same.
Yeah.
Ankle strap, toe strap, very similar. But it's just another.
So for myself, coming from a skateboarding and bit of surfing background, is something like this, would it be recommended for someone who's used to turning kind of on a trucks or on a surfboard? Or is it more for once you're at a certain level and you want that extra bit of play?
I think at your level of snowboarding, you won't be able to tell the difference.
Yeah.
Because you're brand new to it.
Exactly.
So it's kind of more of a play that this is the technology this company's using. It's like, you know, on that LibTech board, how it had that wavy edge?
Yeah.
And that's designed to give you better grip in the ice.
But it's something that someone like myself would definitely not notice.
Correct.
Any difference of.
And some boards have it, some boards don't. It's kind of like some bindings have this, some bindings don't.
Yeah.
You know, the best thing you can do is if you're ever at like a demo.
Yeah.
So up at Whistler, we have demo days a couple of times a year, and you can try this kind of stuff out. Then you can go up and try it for free.
Nice.
And see, do I like it or do I not like it?
Yeah.
But right now it's kind of...
Doesn't make a difference.
I like this company, that's cool, I'll do it.
I mean, I like supporting local companies, so that's always cool, so... Yeah.
this shop has lots of cool local brands like Yes, Now, Dinosaurs Will Die. Yeah. These are all pretty good, cool local good to brands. Know. So yeah.
One other question is the height of the support on the back, which has probably come at the back of your leg. Does that make much of a difference? Because I can see, is this just because of the size, or is that something specific to the binding itself?
Yeah, good question. So if you look at the back of these bindings, you can see that the green one has a much larger high back than this kind of bluey gray one. That green one's gonna, that is gonna give you more support on your boot. So it's gonna give you more support there. Personally, I like having that support.
Yeah.
Some people don't. Now, to give you an example, some people who ride a lot of rails don't like to have that big support on the back because they like to be able to have more movement there. Whereas I find I like that support. It helps with getting your heel edge, turning, just getting support back there. At your level of riding, you probably won't notice the difference either way.
Again, yeah, cool.
So, yeah.
Nice.
All good?
Yeah.
All right, so there we've talked about bindings, boots, boards.
Everything. Obviously,
boards, you have the most variables of different things you want to consider.
Yeah.
Boots, get something super comfy that you're into. And bindings, get something that fits your boots well.
Perfect.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, I feel like I'm all set up, ready to do some shopping.
So now the shopping begins.
Yeah, definitely.
Sweet. Any last questions?
No, I think that's it. I just look forward to taking this knowledge and finding something to get me going.
Right.
Should
on.
Be good.
Sweet. Thanks,
Cheers, Nev. Thank you very much.
This is Nev Lapwood from Snowboard Addiction. Our goal is to improve your riding.
How does a photographer get turned into a cab driver, get turned into a chef? That's a really good question. In the mid-90s, well before digital photography, I got given a film camera and I thought, oh, photographing the night sky, that sounds like a lot of fun. I asked my science teacher, I want to photograph the stars, how do I do that? He said, point it straight south and lock the shutter and see what you see. It was phenomenal. When you see those star trails, the reality sets in that we are the ones spinning around, not the stars. That's just so cool. It really blows my mind even to this day. A couple of years later, I met someone who had actually worked in Whistler, and I'd never heard of the place. Not a skier, not a snowboarder, or anything like that. But I thought, hey, let's go there and check it out. And so I got a job with one of the local photographers. Being up on the mountains, looking at everything every day, that was a game changer. A couple of years later, an opportunity came up to work for Whistler Blacker in the grooming department. Just seeing the environment at night, it's just a whole different other level. It's amazing to take a photograph, but there are times where I just enjoy the beauty that's around me. It's so quiet and peaceful, and it really puts it into perspective. So that's when it started. And I think the first week of the first year, we went up to the Crystal Hut for a fondue dinner, and they were like, this is how you're gonna get to and from the restaurant tonight. It was just the best time ever. I must have spent 10 minutes inside and the rest was outside taking photos. I just thought it was beautiful. A couple of years later, they offered me a job as a chef. You know, I do have a hard time explaining to a lot of my friends what it is I do for a job. And they're like, oh, you're a cook. And it's like, well, yeah, but my restaurant's at 6,000 feet up a mountain. it's not quite an average job. Every single person that comes on our tour has a different background, and everyone comes to Whistler for different reasons, and it's really cool when you take the time to learn why people are here and learn all their stories. Getting to share my experience with guests is fantastic. A lot of people live in big cities, they can't see the stars, they can't see the environment doing its thing. They get to experience these things that are normal to us, but it's not normal to everyone else. We're here year in, year out. These guests come here for a week, a month, whatever it is, and it's a beautiful environment we get to live in. Hopefully they can take something like that home with them.
Spreading the news, I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. Do you, do you? These vagabond shoes along the two streets, right through the very heart of it.
I learned the secret spots of Whistler Blackcomb the hard way. I just had to keep up with the boys. I remember coming downstairs, and my parents were down at the kitchen table, sort of looking at things that I could do in my future and everything, and I had to face them and say, Mom and Dad, I really do want to go to university, but it's important that I get skiing out of my system. Therefore, I'm going to move out west, just do it for 1 year, and then I'll go to university. So when I arrived here and saw what I was calling the Western skiers, sort of the powder skiers that didn't have great style on the groom run, I thought I was pretty cool and I had it happening. But then I realized that skiing was a lot bigger picture than I'd ever experienced. I had a lot to learn. And so it wasn't long before I started chasing this group of skiers into the craziest, wildest terrain I could ever imagine possible. I just thought this mountain went on forever and ever and ever. It was fast, it was challenging, and everything was a new adventure. We started instructional guiding 25 years ago because people were saying, you know, how do you get to this? How do you get to that? You know, we found there's a need for people to know where to go. And Whistler and Blackcomb have this reputation of being a hardcore mountain, of building hardcore skiers. But it is the most incredible training ground possible. My job is as much about teaching skiing as being a psychologist. I get people at their rawest forms. You can work with people and build up their confidence that they feel they can do it. They ski it, then they look up it and they're like, oh my gosh, look what I just did. Like, I just skied that. An easy place to come and push your limits. I found you got better really fast. Every day I went up, I improved, I learned something. And when people have experiences here and conquer something on the hill, it's life-changing. I know personally that people have taken their mind-blowing ski experience and their adventure and made changes for the better. It's hard to say what the limit is. You know, with a glass, you can fill it up or it's gonna go over, but with doing something adventurous, is the go over when you fail?
Oh, that smells good, man.
I don't know. I think if you've got a smile on your face and you're turning left and right down these steep things without falling down, you're the best skier on the mountain.
and soldiers and Nixon coming. We're finally on our own. This summer I hear the drumming for dead in Ohio. Gotta get down to it. Soldiers are cutting us down. Should have been done long ago. What if you knew her and found her dead on the ground? How can you run when you know?
These are four relatively simple maneuvers, but when put together, they offer hours, days, even years of fun on your snowboard. And it'll really get you playing with your snowboard, messing around, and learning lots of new tricks. We're gonna start off with nose presses and tail presses. The best way to get into a press, either nose or tail, is by getting low on your board and really using your ankles, knees, and hips to get the press. You don't want to just lean over with your head and shoulders standing really tall. It'll be hard to get a nice high press, and you're going to have trouble keeping balance. I think about getting low and almost sitting on top of my bindings, bending one knee and really straightening out the other one. And then if I really want to get my board pressed, I don't worry too much about lifting up my foot as much as pressing down on the other one. After you feel comfortable standing there balanced, see if you can hop from one to the other. If you're feeling really confident, see if you can do a tail press nose grab. Try them going down a cat track, pressing on the tail, and then the nose. Once you're comfortable with that, try them side slipping, going from nose to tail and back again. Once you get comfortable with the nose press and tail press, ollies and nollies are much easier. Once you're in that nose press or tail press position, you're right in the spot for a good ollie or nollie. You can go from that pressed nose or tail, jump off that leg right into the air, and there's your ollie or nollie. When I'm doing ollies or nollies, once again, I'm not trying to move my head and shoulders too much. That's where the bulk of my weight is, so I want to keep it steady. I'm going to move from nose to tail or vice versa by getting my lower joints to move underneath me. From here, combined with getting a little lower, I can get in a perfect position to spring off my tail or nose. And then by exploding off of that foot, I can get myself up into the air. I'm really using the flex of my board to spring me up as high as I can go. And don't forget to get your shoulders involved as well. Your shoulders will really dictate where your snowboard's going, so you might as well get them going where you want your snowboard to go. After you spring up, don't forget to absorb your legs up nice and evenly so you can land equally on both feet. Once again, practice ollies somewhere flat where you're not moving. And once you get comfortable, take it to the hill. Preferably somewhere gentle where you're not gonna pick up too much speed. When you're ollieing down the cat track, try and keep a flat base. That's gonna give you more surface area to take off and land on, so that's gonna give you a little bit more balance. Once you've done a few ollies and nollies on the cat track, also try them side slipping down the slope or traversing. We're gonna put this into all kinds of different scenarios, so it's important being comfortable with ollies and nollies in all kinds of different situations. Our third move is gonna be spinning. And we're gonna keep the spinning part pretty simple and just do it on the hill. We're not gonna need any jumps or air or anything like that. We're just gonna spin on the slope. So you can start these spins exactly like how you'd start a turn, by getting your head, shoulders, and hips to rotate. The important part when spinning on the slope is that you make sure your head's looking up over your shoulder continuously. You want to look all the way around until you see back to where you started. You might find you want to look down or underneath your arm as you're spinning. This is just going to throw off your balance and make it awkward to get a smooth spin. Keeping your head up, looking over your shoulders is the ideal way to have a nice smooth spin. You can start by doing 360s from a side slip, starting and finishing in the same place. Do it both front side and back side to get comfortable both ways. after you've done a few side slipping, try them going straight down the hill. Once again, find a slope that's not too steep so you're not going to pick up too much speed. After you get 360s dialed and you're pretty comfortable doing them nice and smoothly around, try spinning as much as you can. Do a 7, 10, 12, 14, go until you get dizzy and fall over. Once you've fallen over, regain your consciousness again and try going the other way just to unwind yourself. The last move we're gonna use is the shifty. Shifties are great all over the place. They work really well when you're riding park because they're a great way to scrub speed without changing your trajectory like a turn would. They also just add a little bit of spice into lots of maneuvers. A shifty is simply a counter-rotated movement where your upper body and lower body go opposite directions. I think about putting my hands over my tail when I do a frontside shifty and over my nose when I do a backside shifty. You should feel a bunch of tension in your torso, and that's what you're going to use to pop your board back and forth. Once you get comfortable doing shifties, play with them a little bit more. Do them down the hill, both side slipping and going straight down the hill, and see how big you can make them. 90 degrees isn't a stopping point. 90 degrees is a great place to start. See if you can overshifty and do a full 180 and bring it back again. Once you've got these four moves mastered, or at least you're starting to feel comfortable with them, it's time to start playing with them and introducing them to one another. It's time to put them into all kinds of different combinations. And I'm going to show you a few of these combinations right now. We'll start simply and then build it up. Another one you can do from spinning is just get that spin going like you were before and then just put one of your legs underneath you, just like we were doing when we were pressing. This will create a nice nose butter or tail butter. Nose rolls and tail rolls are a great way to move from switch to regular and back again, and they look really good when you're doing it. A good step-by-step to introduce nose rolls and tail rolls, you could simply start rotating 180s forwards and backwards on the snow, and then just add a little bit of a press in the middle of it, simply by putting one of your legs underneath your body. From there, you'll slowly get comfortable rotating with one end of the board in the air. If that starts to get too easy, do a bit of a pop out of it. We already know how to ollie, so you know exactly how that feels. You might even be surprised to notice you spin even more than a 180. You might do a nose roll and end up coming around a full 360. That's not a bad thing, you're just adding to your bag of tricks. When you're experimenting, use as few or as many of these moves as you can. There's no wrong way to do them, and there's an endless amount of tricks that you can learn. Do a few simple ones and then move into more and more complex maneuvers. Try adding spins into presses. Throw a little bit of a shifty in there and then pop out of it. There's really no right or wrong way to do this, and you're only limited by your own imagination. Learn tricks off your friends and show them tricks that you've come up with. I'm Duncan Mainland, this is Snowboard Addiction, and our goal is to improve your riding.
く戦場で金の自信の剣を手に時を割いて私の方へと近づいてきた Maybe 慈悲を願う私の叫び白い旗はすでにあげたが愛で死ぬなら傷で殺して旅人のように生きてきた宿のないこの心が Baby さまよいたどり着いたところはあなたという大地赤い情熱
Flown across the ocean, leaving just a memory. Snapshot in the family album. Daddy, what else did you leave me?All in all, it's just another brick in the wall. All in all, it's just another brick in the wall.
You guys heard of snowboard addiction before?
Yeah, nice.
Yeah, right on.
Yeah,
sweet.
Watch your YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Nice.
Nice.
One of you guys want to get some tips?
Yeah, sure, please.
All right, we'll stand up and let's get to, you know what? Come over here, it's a bit softer. Okay. So, what's your name?
Fabin.
Sorry.
Fabin.
Nice to meet you, man. Nev, nice to meet you. So you've been watching Snowboard Addiction on YouTube?
Yeah, pretty good channel.
Yeah? What's your favorite thing?
Jumps.
Jumps?
Give me tips for jumps, yeah.
Right on. Have you been riding the park already today?
No, not really.
Nope?
Just come, my third time doing park?
Third time ever?
Ever.
Third time ever, okay. So what kind of stuff are you doing?
Just normal basic landing, hit the jumps,
yep.
Landing stuff, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Hit line it, you know, making sure that speed's right, speed checks.
Perfect. Well, maybe what we'll do then is I'll get an idea of these first couple of jumps, seeing what you can do.
Cool.
And then I'll be able to give you some tips for how you could improve that going forward.
Perfect.
How's that sound?
Sounds good to me.
All right. How did it go?
Good, man.
Good. What did you think?
It's good.
Did it feel smooth?
Wish I got my landing a bit better.
Yeah? On which jump?
Second one.
Second one, okay.
Like, I had my body 2 points here.
Okay.
Like, bracing myself.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I watched both your jumps, and I've got some feedback for you.
Perfect.
One thing I noticed is that you actually hit the jumps quite fast. And I would recommend slowing down a bit and adding a little bit more pop into your jumps. Do you know what that means?
From the back, is it?
Well, there's actually... There's two ways you can do this. One is just a simple flex and extend with the legs as you're going over the jump. So if you can imagine coming into a jump, how you got a downhill running, and then you got the flat and you got the little uphill.
Yeah.
It's the process of being tall, flexing down a little bit, and extending up a little bit just to go off that jump. What that's gonna do, it's gonna add pop into your jump.
Because right now you're clearing the jumps fine, but you're going quite fast. And if you actually add a little bit of leg flicks that extend off the jump, you're going to get more height and you're going to go further. So as a result, you'll actually be able to take it slower. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. So you're coming in slower, get that pump in.
Correct.
More control yourself.
And what it's going to do, it's actually going to look better too.
Yeah.
It's not only going to give you better control, it's going to give you better style. Yeah. And you're going to feel like you're in control of the jump. So on the next jumps, I'm going to go first and I'm going to show you what I mean. I'm going to go down, flex, extend, add a bit of pop, and then you can try to do exactly what I do.
Nice.
Cool.
Sounds good to me.
The other thing I spotted, the other thing I spotted was that as you were riding in, you were kind of doing a lot of turns and speed checking. What I like to do, and this is what I teach people, is kind of pick where you're going to go from, slow down, and then go straight at the jump. Because then you'll be able to concentrate on that pop rather than kind of thinking about all your speed all the time. So you'll see me ride in, slow down, and ride straight to it, and concentrate on my pop. Let's go. All right. Fab. What we have is we have two small jumps similar to the other ones. And this time what you're going to do is go ever so slightly slower, but add a little bit more leg movement to get pop off this jump. I'm going to hit the first one so you can see how I do it. Then I'm going to stop on the second one, but I want you to hit both of them. I'll watch you on the second one and the first one. Okay? Rip it up. Watch my legs, how I pop off this jump. So how did it feel?
Better.
Better?
Control, so it's just like just flowing over, no fear. More control, you just pop it.
The second one of your jumps, I think, looked a little bit better than your first one. Would you agree?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. On the first one, it looked like your timing was a little bit off.
Yeah, I was doing the speed checks as usual.
Correct.
So the second one, I just headlined it. Took it slow enough and just popped it through better.
Correct. So if you're not doing the speed checks, you can concentrate on that pop.
Yeah.
And as you get the feeling of doing that, you're going to get your timing better at it.
Yeah.
Once you get the timing good, you're going to find that it's going to float, you're going to feel higher, and you'll be able to start to do things like add grabs, which will just make it look better.
Yeah. You're more comfortable with it.
Is that cool?
Sick.
All right.
Thanks a million.
No problem. I hope that helps you, and that's something you can practice on your next few runs to get the feeling of that.
Perfect. Sweet. Thanks, bro.
Oh, and I wanted to add another tip.
Yeah.
Is that that movement I was telling you was kind of like a flexing down with the legs and extending up. That's a pop.
Yeah.
And as you get better, you can start through what's called an ollie. Do you know what an ollie is?
I've heard of it, but I'm not too sure.
So an ollie is when you're jumping off the back of your snowboard. It's a little bit more advanced. So don't worry about that for now. That's the next step up. But that's how you get the most height off these jumps. But right now, it's just that simple leg flexing and extending and getting the timing of that so that as you take off a lip of the jump, you're fully extended and then kind of sucking it back up in the air. And then that's what's going to give you a better trajectory, better style, and better pop off these jumps.
That's good, man.
All thanks right.
Then.
Thank you.
Thank
Cheers.
You.
Thanks for being part of our video.
No problem at all, man.
This is Nev Lapwood from snowboardaddiction.com. We're up here with Fab. It's a beautiful sunny day and we're helping everybody improve their riding. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a look at my life and realize there's none left, cause I've had a glass of life and so long that even more things than the world is gone.
Tell by the way I use my walk. I'm a woman's man, no time to talk. Music loud and women warm. I've been kicked around since I was born. And now it's alright, it's okay. You can't look the other way. We can't try, understand. New York Times effect on man. Whether you're a brother, whether you're a mother. Being alive, being alive. Feel the city breaking.
Loves her mama, loves Jesus and America too. I'm a bad boy, 'cause I don't even miss her. I'm a bad boy, I'm breaking her heart. And I'm free, free falling. Yes, I'm free, free falling.
I fly like paper, get high like planes. If you catch me at the border, I got visas in my name. If you come around here, I'll make them all day. I'll get one done in a second if you wait. I fly like paper, get high like planes. If you catch me at the border, I got visas in my name. If you come around here, I'll make them all day. I'll get one done in a second if you wait. Sometimes I think sitting on trains. Every stop I get to, I'm clocking that game. Everyone's a winner, been making our fame. Bonafide hustler, making my name. Sometimes I think sitting on trains. Every stop I get to, I'm clocking that game.
It's January 14th, and the rumor was yesterday, not the rumor, I got this from the Lifties, that and they said if you're a betting man, that I would come tomorrow, which is today, because the peak chair is more than likely going to open. Now, saying that, I just got on the Creekside Gondola, and it's minus 17, and they just said with the wind chill, at the top of the Creekside Gondola, it's minus 37, so... Is the peak chair gonna open? Then it, maybe not. I might just go home.
Oh yeah!
It's another hike to the peak, but this time with the Whistler ski bum. Yeah, and the peak's running and it's about to crack. We just got word from patrol. Yeah, and so symphony, and nobody's here. Oh, it's so slow for the cold, eh? Oh, yeah, so many tracks in here now. This is the official first weight of the year at the peak chair. January 14th, 2020. And we just got the word that it is cracking. Just be patient. And we got it from your friend. Dude. Officially the first ride on the peak chair, even though they opened it and we were hiked up again like dummies. Not you guys. Yeah. Woo! Woo-hoo! You gotta get in the edit again. Woo! Blast that shit! Oh! Wait out! Yeah! Woo! Woo! Dude, right down here, Dave. Oh! Woo! Oh! Woo! Yeah! Woo! Woo! Yeah, boys! Woo! Oh! Davy Jones Foot Locker. This is the Foot Locker. Oh, shit! Oh, fuck! Woo! Oh, watch the tree! Good thing I was a ballet skier. Ooh. Oh, this is tough.
speak if I don't say. I won't speak if you won't. But I won't tell if you don't. You can trust me. If I'm asleep, then I'm not breathing. I'll break before.
It's gonna be a bloodbath of cops dying in LA. Yo, Dre, I got something to say. Fuck, fuck, fuck the police. Fuck, fuck, fuck the police. Fuck, fuck, fuck the police.
Before can look you in the eye, you're just like an angel. Your skin makes me cry. You look like a feather in the beautiful world. You're so I wanna have control.
perfect body. I want a perfect soul. I want you to notice when I'm not around. You're so special, so very special. But I'm a creep, I'm a weirdo. Why the hell am I doing here? I don't belong here. She's running on again. Hey, she's running on.
Hello. So I had a request about my backcountry gear, which I don't really know much about. So I'm just going to check the specs on my phone. So I got the G3 senders right here. Those are replaced from my Empires. And these ones are stiffer and they're longer. These are 181. By 112 underfoot and 139 on the tip and 127 on the tail. There's a bit of camber in here. Woo! But mostly rocker. And these are stiff. These suckers are stiff, so they really make you ski forward. It says dropping in. Dream of big mountains and backcountry free ride missions? Then the sender is your ride. Okay, so what I found personally was they push you forward. So like aggressive ski, like these are an aggressive ski. So the ones that these replaced, the Empires that I had last year, were a full rocker and you could like, you know, did lazy boy in the back seat. And these ones, no chance, stiff. Starting to like them. I've only skied on them I've skied on them four times now, I think. Yeah, four different days. Yeah, and I've already beaten them up. Like, I've got a course shot already, but I can fix them. So anyway, so that's the skis. They're longer and yeah, they ski more like my Black Crows, which are a lot stiffer than all the other mushy vocals I'm skiing on. Now, the bindings are just the G3. I don't know, they were on my other skis. Let's see. These are G3 bindings. Oh, so these are the G3 Ion 12s. And these were on my Empires. So they just moved them over onto here. I did have a couple issues with these. They warrantied them, no problem. One of these magnetic little latches stopped working, and I think the pins were bending or something. Anyways, they're awesome. They just warrantied them. But yeah, they're light. These skis are, with these bindings, are really light. Let's see. What does it say? The most intuitive, reliable, and powerful lightweight touring binding, period. Okay, sure. I really don't know much about them. So I know they work. I know you open them up, you put your feet in.
Ooh, I'm starting to get better at this binding thing here. Ooh, like, yeah!
You like those ones?
You go down, you ski around. When you're touring, you pull them up all the way.
And I can feel that it's the positions.
When you're climbing up. Yeah, it's not very much to them. Easy to turn. The heel piece right here. Then when you step on your boot, they lock in. One thing I learned the hard way. Watch this. You want a glove on when you do this. Yeah, I don't even want to do it. Where's a glove? All right, so you're out there and you want to turn your bindings back? Put a glove on. This sucker's going to go. Watch this. And you don't want to get your hands stuck in here. It's not a whole pile of fun. I did it. All right, so for the skins, okay. Those skins are just these G3 Alpinists. They are on my Empires and now they're on here. So they're a little bit on the short side because these are skis are longer by 6 centimeters, I think.
I was struggling a lot.
You can just fix them. You can wax them and stuff, right?
Because I'm really light, I might need the extra...
Oh, the extra sticky ones?
There's the extra grip version.
Yeah, they don't go downhill well, but they go uphill good.
But again, because I'm light, that might not be a factor.
Yeah.
It might just give me the help I need.
But that's all right for me. It's okay. I don't know much about these Alpinists, but I just checked on their website. And if you go on the G3 website, they've done all the research. They can tell you why to buy them. I just know that they're decent. I can climb up with them. Yeah, they stick. These are 3 years old now, and they are on their, they're 3 years old and they are on their third pair of skis. Because they started off on my Vocal Ones, went to my G3 Empires, and now they're on the G3 Senders. So they've got some longevity. I don't actually even know how long they're supposed to last. And the last part of the gear is the same, G3 again. I don't know anything about these poles except you can make them longer or shorter. They've got some markings on here. There's some markings on here for your depth. Or, you know, like you can pull them apart if you're a tall guy, short person. And yeah, so when you're skiing and you're side hilling, you can extend it or lower it. I don't usually bother. And it's got a little grip here for your hand, you know, so you can have different levels. You can move this up and down. And then I have my selfie ski here. So if I want to like shoot myself. Woo! I just throw the GoPro on here. This thing doesn't weigh anything, so I don't even bother taking it off. And that's it. So yeah, I'm kind of like G3'd out because so the store in Squamish, Escape Route, and they're in Whistler as well, but they sell a lot of G3 stuff. So I just kind of like, I just went with it and it's been working. Yeah, like I said, the bindings did get warrantied, but it wasn't a big deal. I just waited till the end of the year and yeah, they're fine. So that's my backcountry stuff. That's it. That's all I got on this one. You know, this stuff that comes between your skins when you buy them? Summer storage. Don't take it out in the wood. Don't take it out with you. You'll just lose them. A little wind comes by and like, gone. Don't eat it.
Gets her through her busy day. do. I hear every mother say, cooking fresh food for her husband's just a drag. So she buys an instant cake, and she buys her frozen steak, and goes running for the shelter of her mother's little helper. 'Cause it helps her run away, gets her through her busy day. Doctor, please, some more of these. Outside the door, she took far more. What a drag it is getting old. Men just aren't the same today. I hear every mother say, they just don't appreciate that you get tired. They're so hard to satisfy. You can tranquilize your mind, so go running for the shelter of your mother's little helper, just to help you through the night, help to minimize your plight. Doctor, please, some more of these. Outside the door, she took far more. What a drive.
I could never live without you by my side. Then I spent so many nights thinking how you'd done me wrong, and I grew strong. I learned how to carry on, and so you're back. From outer space I just walked in to find you here with that dumb look upon your face. Would've changed my stupid lock, I'd have made you leave your key. If I'd have known for just 1 second you'd be back to bother me. Now go walk out the door, just turn around, no, you're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to break me with desire? Did you think I'd crumble? Think I'd lay down and die? No, not I will survive as long as I know how to love. I know I'll stay alive. Got all my life to live. Got all my life to give. I will survive. Will survive. Took all the strength I had not to fall apart. Kept trying hard to mend the pieces of this broken heart. I spent oh so many nights feeling sorry for myself. I used to cry. Now I hold my head up high and you'll see me. Somebody knew I'm not that chained up little person still in love with you. And so you thought you'd just drop by and you expect me to be free. But now I'm saving all my loving for someone who's loving me. Now go walk out the door, just turn around, now you're not welcome anymore. You tried to break me with goodbye.
There's a lot of people that know who I am just because of where I lived. But I didn't realize it when I was little. Living on the mountain just was what it was, and the kind of ironic thing about it is I'd go to friends' houses who had super fancy houses and all the toys in the world, and I'd be like, oh, I don't have that. You know, it's dumb. I lived on the mountain. I had something you couldn't buy. In 1978, my parents moved up there because there was the Tony Seiler ski camps, and they needed someone up there to do different things, from starting the lifts, just for security, making sure that people got down off the mountain at the end of the day. And so my parents lived up there and got pregnant, and then they took me to the top of the mountain when I was 3 days old. Growing up in the mountain didn't seem like a different childhood. You assume that what your life is like is normal. But looking back now, it's definitely a privilege to be able to grow up there. It would either be my mom or my dad that would head out in the mornings to go like start the lifts and stuff. But I don't really feel like we had necessarily a set routine. I think there's more of a freedom up there in the sense, because where are you gonna go? You know, that's where life is up there. My mom and I would always do top to bottoms. So we'd start at the roundhouse and then we'd go down Pony Trail, Orange Peel, and then go do Dave Murray down to the valley and then come back up. That's still a run that I will do as a family. I mean, the mountains are the mountains. You know, the runs are still the same, the trees are still the same, things shift over time. But the way the lifts run now is completely different. When my parents were up there, I believe the gondola based have to start from the top. It was kind of that old school way of things were done, right? I mean, you used to sit on chairlifts for ages, and on those stormy days, you'd be freezing and the hard, like, wooden chairlift seats. But now, lift access has changed so much. You just move through it so quickly, and then all of a sudden, you're up at the top. It's kind of incredible. Seeing people come off the top of the peak chair and look out and see that view of Black Tusk, they're just in complete awe. I mean, I can look at that over and over again and I'm still blown away. And then being able to ski down that mountain and get to the bottom, there's a way to get down. Like, you don't have to be able to ski a Black Diamond to access that. They get that feeling in their, like, deep in their soul of just that freedom and that lightness. It's really cool to see people experience that. The ease of being able to get around to different places just from where they place lifts and where you can get to is kind of giving an opportunity to explore more of the mountain. When I first saw the towers going up for the peak to peak, I was like, what are they doing? And now that it's there, it's awesome to be able to have that ability to jump from mountain to mountain, or your friends over on Whistler, you're like, cool, I'll be there in 15 minutes. You can just get on the peak to peak and cut across. There's something cool about that. You know, after we moved off the mountain, my dad had lived there for so long, they let us stay up and then at the end of the day do the sweep with patrol. There's something about skiing down the mountain when it's getting dark. The sun's going down and there's just this like beautiful orangey glow. You get that feeling kind of inside your chest and inside your stomach, just of the sheer beauty of that brightness of that alpenglow. All of a sudden it ends and there's that like deep, dark kind of blue that sets in. And it's something you just sit there and watch for hours, but it fades quickly, making it extra special. It's cool being able to bring the kids up on the mountain because it gives kind of this like refreshed perspective of the mountain again. I mean, their view is different just because their home is their home, and that was my home. And home to me is somewhere that when you come back to that place, you feel comfortable and you feel at ease. You feel that feeling inside your heart return. and for a lot of people, that is the mountains.
Okay, dropping in 10. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, dropping.
One more year and then you'll be Good morning, guys. It is currently 5 a.m. I don't know if that's in focus, but anyways, me and Brennan here.
Hey, what's going on, fellas?
As known as the Platty Daddy, we are on our way to Whistler. We're gonna go ride some sleds today. It's supposed to be somewhat nice out and some fresh snow, so we're pretty excited. It's gonna be a good day. We got some bros going up. Meeting a bunch of people up in Squamish, road tripping up, get to Whistler, go have some fun. What do you have to say, Bren?
Not much. You know, it's the Platty Daddy here. We're gonna be opening up the vlog today for the peeps. You know.
Keep rolling, buddy.
Keep rolling. There's not that much new snow. Well, there might be a little bit, but we're gonna not set our bars too high and then hope for the best, I guess.
Yeah, our hopes aren't too high, so we won't be thoroughly disappointed when we get up there and there isn't much snow. We have no idea what the conditions are gonna be like. What we do know is that we have some epic slow motion, we have some cool cameras, we have some fucking awesome riders, and we're just there to have a good time and do our thing. So maybe we'll just roll the Squam and we will meet you guys up there. So we're rolling into Squamish right now. We're gonna grab some gas, some 94 octane for Chevron. I just remembered that in the video the other day of me putting my wrap on, I burnt the shit out of my intake. And so I was totally kidding about running an open intake. I am not doing it. So we have to come up with a solution for that. Not too sure what we're gonna do yet. But that's the situation right now. There goes the boys. Wherever Jer is. Jer, where are you at, boy?
He's a bit behind us.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're gonna grab some Chevron here. We're also gonna grab some Tim's. We're starving. Look at everybody else. Got the same idea.
These fucking guys work.
Alright. Don't people work these days? Frick.
Getting gas and some other things there, Jared. See you up there, bud.
So we're at Steve's at No Limits Motorsports. It's obviously closed. But yeah, we're just waiting. That was the plan we came up with. Because I'm an idiot. And I burnt it up.
Fucking dum-dum salad over there. It's gonna be sunny today.
Yeah.
I don't know. You're wasting our fucking time, buddy.
Yeah, it's gonna be bluebird. It's gonna be sick up there.
Yeah, I wish we were up there already.
Yep. If somebody didn't burn their intake, we would've been up there. With the boys.
Oh, boys, well. The boys are gonna get all the fresh tracks before we even get up there. Mother F.
Can you do? Gonna move the rig for me. Should say us. Get this place open, get an intake, get out to the mountain. That's the plan.
It's on sleds, on sleds, on sleds, on sleds, on sleds. On sleds, on sleds, on sleds, on sleds, on sleds.
How did you get the sleds in the video?
Got a couple sleds in the video.
Hey guys, so we're just rolling up to the spot here. We're going to Sprout Lake. It's an awesome riding area. It's kind of like tree riding. If you wanted to go big mountain or whatever, that's kind of brand new one area. But yeah, Sprout's sick. It's super good riding area. A lot of people love it. Brennan seems to really like it for some reason. It's the only fucking place this guy rides.
I like it because the boys like it.
Yeah. That's how you get it out.
Hey guys, so me and Brennan found the good stuff. We found a little hole. It's up top, it's pretty wind blowing, so the snow's not that great up there. But down in the holes, you can definitely find some good snow. So we got a couple shots, and I think we're gonna go back and find the crew. What do you think? Stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it. They would not know how to stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it. Even if I gave it to them, they would not know how to stir it. They would not know how to chef. Watch me cut, cut. Fresh as fire, you might see me in a look, but should've known I was coming for your spot, spot. Should've known I was headed to the top, side. I was on a plane when I realized that I'm what. They all sound the same, they don't sound nothing like us. Young, young, whoosh, I'm a guy with the bus. Young, young, whoosh, you might have to catch the bus. Ay. Young, young, whoosh, let me speak on the real, real quick. Man, I'm hungry, so I set me up a meal real quick. I see money, let me go and make a meal real quick. Found a baddie, made a mind, but she a real chill chick. Groupies wondering if they the one. She say she love me, man, that shit just made me run. Oh my God. This is easy, man, I made this song in one day. They say Gucci, Wooshi, you gon' blow up one day. That's cause I'm the one with the sauce. Chef Lagasse with the pans and the pots. They want the recipe, ain't that a first? Even if I gave it to them, they would not know how to stir it. They would not know how to stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it. Stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it. They would not know how to stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it, stir it. Even if I gave it to them, they would not know how to stir it. They would not know how to stir it. Hey guys, so me and Brandon are on our way home now. Done riding for the day. It wasn't great, but it wasn't bad either. Snow was really wind blown up top, like I said. And then if you got it down into a honey hole, it was good. Brandon, what do you think about today?
Sorry.
Yeah, it was pretty alright.
Bit of a drive for mediocre snow.
Yeah, from like our house to Whistler, like where our riding zones is like 2 hours. So, but yeah, it was nice to get out. Actually, it was nice to get out with the Elkas and try those out on like the groomers and get into some whoops. And then also into a little bit of powder and stuff like that. And all around so far, I'm loving them. They're working really well. And also my camera box is awesome, works great, super easy to get the camera out, do my thing. That's it for this time. We'll catch you guys later. Say bye, Brent.
Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.
As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a look at my life and realize there's much left. 'Cause I've been blasting and laughing so long that even my mama thinks that my mind is gone. I really hate to trip, but I gotta look. As they croak, I see myself in the pistol smoke. I'm the kind of G the little homies wanna be like, on my knees in the night, saying prayers in the streetlight. Been spending most their lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most our lives living in the gangster's paradise. Power and the money, money and the power. Minute after minute, hour after hour. I'm a loped out gangster, sad tripping banger. And my brothers is down, so don't arouse my anger. Tell me why are we so blind to see that the ones we hurt are you?
Michael Horst. I'm the heli ski operations manager at Tyax Lodge and Heli Ski. At Tyax, we have an incredible and experienced group working as a team in the field. two guides, one pilot, one helicopter, 10 guests or less. We have over 1 million acres that we go and ski, and in these million acres, we have only 4 helicopters and up to 40 skiers out skiing in a day. We go and we find the best snow and the best skiing, and we continue skiing until everyone is happy and satiated with powder skiing before they return home on Friday.
One of the benefits of coming to TIAX is our close proximity to Vancouver. This means that the time that you spend on your heli ski holiday are actually spent here at the lodge and skiing, and not with spending a lot of time transferring.
The great thing about the Chilcotins, which is where this area is located, is that it's a drier snowpack on the coast here. So we get unbelievable snow conditions, dry, light, deep, and a lot of great skiing for people that come here.
People do come to TIAX, they do have the ability to choose the length of their ski holiday. You can go as short as 3 days and as long as 7 days. And that's our signature program. We've also got a more exclusive platinum program, which we offer private chalet, which includes a private massage therapist, a private chef, and a concierge.
My name is Brooklyn. I'm a massage therapist here at TIAX Lodge and Heli Skiing. We offer our clients anywhere between a 25-minute, 50-minute, or an 80-minute treatment of either a relaxation massage or a sports massage, so including deep tissue, shiatsu. We use different elements from different modalities. And yeah, every massage is catered to the guest's needs.
For our operation, to ensure that our guests have an amazing experience, stay very safe, the guides meet every morning at 6 a.m., sometimes even earlier. We go through every single run in the million acres that we have and talk about whether it should be open or closed for the day as a team. And we're choosing runs that we believe are going to be a lot of fun and safe for our guests to ski.
People are out skiing. However, when they are not, we do have a full range of activities here at the lodge. We always have an ice hockey rink.
Duarte. I'm the executive chef here at TIAX Lodge and Heli Skiing. I'm originally from Montreal, and my love for cooking has taken me abroad on a few occasions. Here at TIAX, I manage a team of 10 cooks, all of which very passionate, and they all contribute in their own unique way to our guest experience here at TIAX. We serve our food in a luxurious setting among the wilderness. Me and my team look forward to meeting you.
Groups are single groups with one helicopter dedicated to their own group. We have an unlimited vertical package, and a vertical guarantee. For a 7-day group, we guarantee 30,500 meters.
I've been living in the Sea to Sky corridor in Whistler for the last 25 years, and I've flown sort of in this region, and I think it's one of the most beautiful areas that to fly in, just from an aesthetically, I mean, beautiful mountains challenge. And, you know, I think that the Tayax operation here is world class and top notch.
Superstars. She pulled my hair and put my lipstick on in the glass of her boudoir. There's nothing wrong with loving who you are, she said, 'cause we made you perfect, babe. So hold your head up, girl, and you'll go far. Listen to me when I say,
I'm beautiful in my way, cause God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Don't hold yourself in regret, just love yourself and you say, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Hey, ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Oh, ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Give yourself prudence and love your friends. Subway, give rejoice your truth. In the religion of the insecure, I must be myself, respect my youth. I'm not a lover, it's not a sin. Believe, capital H-I-N-N-M. I love my life, I love this record. And me, I'm more for la boya. I'm beautiful in my way. No mistakes, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Don't hold yourself in regret, just love yourself and you say, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Hey, ooh, there ain't no other way, baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Oh, ooh, there ain't no other way, baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Be a drag, just be a queen. Whether you're broke or evergreen, you're black, white, Asian, let it say, Lebanese, you're Orient. Whether life's disabilities left you outcast, will lead to tears. Rejoice and love yourself today, cause baby, you were born this way. Oh, oh, oh.
Yeah, I'm good, dude.
This looks like it's gonna slide.
Okay, we're gonna watch you go.
I'll just take this new bit of pace, cause it's probably gonna slide.
Yeah, okay, we're just gonna watch you go. So his first time down the Hobbit track. I don't think there's gonna be much turning going on. Woo! Sick. And then just a straight line. Woo! Yeah! Yeah! So we just skied down the hover tracks. That was really not scary. We can go this way. I think we gotta go down here. Oh! I didn't win! I didn't win. Look here. So this is where we're going right here. Let's just have a look. And take your pick, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just say pick your line and let's go.
What?
Woo! Oh, that was worth the hike. Oh yeah, that was worth the hike right there. Nice. Yeah. Don't tell me that wasn't worth the hike.
Awesome.
Yeah, Sid. Sid, he's shaking his bank. Yeah, bro.
Yeah!
Yeah!
That was fun!
Dude, that's adventures right there. Woo! Whoa! Alright, good though. It's steep as shit, man. Woo! Holy crap. Woo! And the snow sucks! Wow, that was brutal! Dropping some silos. Get this shit coming at you. Oh. Yay! We got another one. Okay, I'm just gonna go. Adventures with Flow Rider, winter version. Okay, well, when Flow Rider says it's Rick approved, mind you, he didn't say any of that this time. He just said, I need you to get a iPhone picture of me. Oh, just trying to get over here. Still. Oh, motherfucker. Oh, I can't swear. Holy crapola. How's that sound? All right. So, Ryder, what do you call this one?
Just keep that. shook me all night. Walking double time in this seduction lane. She was one of a king, she was made of me. One need no applause, just another cause. She made a meal out of me and it came back for more. Had to kill me then to have another ring. Now I'm back in the ring to have another swing. The walls are shaking, the effort's quaking. Got a quick hand. He'll look around the room. He won't tell you his plan. He got a rolled cigarette hanging out his mouth. He's a cowboy kid. Yeah, found a six-shooter gun in his dad's closet with a box of fun things. And I don't even know what, but he's coming for you. Yeah, he's coming for you. Surprise, cause the dinner's in the kitchen and it's packed and nice. And I waited for a long time. Yeah, the slide of my hand is now a quick pull trigger. Reason with my cigarette and say your hair's on fire. You must have lost your wits. Only at the kids with the pumped up kicks. You better run, better run. Now I'm on a
I just love meeting these people from Hawaii. She was from Hawaii, that woman.
Really?
Yeah.
Subscribe right now, damn it!
Yeah! Need to put some stickers up here, eh? Yeah. Remember to bring some next time. I got some bigger ones getting made. Do you qualify? I think so. What is this hike though?
Blackstone
Glacier. Blackstone Glacier. Just walk. Alright.
All right, kid. What's this called? I didn't hear you. Zut, zut, as in, it's a zut, it's a zit, but a zut. Every time we go somewhere with them, there's a double black sign. You! It's sketchy, isn't it? You know, I've come up there and people behind me started yelling at me. Yeah, because I wasn't going fast enough for them. Total. And I'm like, woohoo! Sure. All right, and that's the way you do it. What's this? Sorry?
Diamond bowl.
Diamond bowl.
See that?
Yep.
Called wild.
It looks wild. About it. Oh, that's that one. That's really steep, right? And you gotta go over like this. Yeah, no. I know what he's talking about. I did it last year on the Shiro Juniors. Oh, there's a traverse. It's like this wide over the cliff. Oh, yeah. Well, it wasn't that wide last year when I did it in March. I don't know, do you want to go? I done it.
Yeah, I'll do it.
All right, let's go. Yeah, it's pretty thin, dude. It's had a lot of wind blowing up here. This ain't it, is it? I remember going farther over than this. Well, maybe this is, you're right. Oh. There's only two lines down out of here though, right? Coming down there, Ryder? I got my camera on you. Hey, either side's good, Tamer. That side's a bit steeper there, or? Yeah, not icy, hard pack. Look at, you're the Schluffinator. Okay? You're the Schluffinator. Okay, the spot I remember, Ryder, was more in the trees, I think. This had to be it. Yeah, no. We ain't at it all yet, though, you know. I'm kind of liking that line. Yeah, I don't know if I... Yeah. That's okay. Yeah. That's pretty freaking steep though, ain't it? Thanks, buddy.
Shaka-laka-laka-boom, boom, shaka-laka-laka-boom, shaka-laka-laka-boom, shaka-laka-laka-boom. I'll take you higher, baby, 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 take you higher. I'll take you higher, baby, 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 take you higher. Hey. Sud et le nord, je connais la ville de haut en bas.
assez haut. Je tergiverse entre le sud et le nord. Je connais la ville de haut en bas. Et mes bas, en effet, vont trop bas. Et mes hauts ne vont jamais assez haut. Ne vont jamais assez haut.
It's a sunny day and I'm waiting in line, not for powder, but to see if I can do a sub 5 minute peak to creek. We're gonna find out. Okay, well, we're on first chair. We wait, like I said, we waited for a groomer. And looks decent actually, but yeah, we're gonna go ahead peak to creek. All right, the time starts when you get at the corner though, not here.
All right.
So on your GoPro, because you're not on the run yet, right?
Well, the loading and doing loop is crazy.
Yeah, for sure. All right. So I start the time right at this corner. Because now you're on it. Oh, it's powder! Woo! legs are burning now. Oh man. Woo! Oh, it's getting shitty. Oh, brutal. That's oh man! Woo! Dude!
Crazy.
Oh.
On your GoPro it says 6 minutes 35 seconds right by now.
Yeah, but it was turned on.
Yeah.
Dude, you were ripping!
That was good.
He came by me.
I slowed down because I didn't know where to go.
I was very careful to make sure you had half a run to yourself at least.
No, I didn't care. It was fine.
Yeah.
Dude, that was wicked.
Pretty conscious not to cut people off.
He said my legs are destroyed.
LLZ, let's go! Back in the gondola!
Shakalaka-laka-boom, shakalaka-laka-boom. Boom, shakalaka-laka-boom, shakalaka-laka-boom, shakalaka-laka-boom. I'll take you higher. Baby, 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 take you higher. I'll take you higher. Baby, 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 take you higher.
like I am fun again. However far away, I will always love you. However long I stay, I will always love you. Whatever words I say, I will always love you.
Start spreading the news.
Let's do this.
What's up, guys? Another beautiful powder day on Whistler. The winter is finally here! And today's gonna be my first day trying out a Karoo-shaped snowboard. This is the T-Finder. It comes in two sizes, the 54 and 57. And it's got their signature white top sheet and red base. The profile on this is camber between the insert points, and then you have a nice rockered out shovel nose, and then a stunted kind of poppy tail to it, so you get a nice kick off of this tail. Centered base, poplar core, yeah, nice and responsive, got a lot of energy out of it. Really fun in these trees. It's kind of taking that like surfboard inspired feel and trying to bring it to all places on the mountain. Andreas, looks like a sick board. What is that?
Oh man, this is the Karoo-shaped dart in a 156.